Okay. The whole presentation is divided into five parts. First, I'm going to give you a brief introduction of difference between what is extradose bridges and how it is different than a conventional cable stayed bridges, and what are the general structural consideration one has to keep in mind by a designer while conceptualizing and analyzing and designing a extradose bridge, and a few examples to differentiate between different type or different forms of the extradose bridges, and then hardware which is being used, which is only dedicated for making such extradose bridges, and lastly a complete design example of a bridge which is under construction in Delhi, extradose bridge, the complete analysis, what are the load effect one has to consider in extradose bridge, and how one can utilize MIDAS software to for analysis purpose of such a complicated bridge. First, the extradose bridge is being originated in somewhere in 1980s, and the Christian man is the first one who has thought of extradose bridges. It's just nothing but a external tendon being taken off from a conventional in-house of a box to above the box. So it's get anchored or divided from a short pylon so that you can get a more lever arm of the pre-stress, that is P into E, and in addition to it, the actual component you are always is available. Now, how it is different than a conventional girder bridge or a cable stayed bridge? The first figure what you are seeing is a conventional girder bridge, let's say we constructed by a cantilever construction. The upper limit for such construction is around 100 meter, although the people has gone up to 150 meter in India, but a constructing a 10 meter depth of the box girder for a 150 meter span, I think it's not a good idea. So if you're going for a girder bridge with a more than 100 meter, it's not going to be economical at all. You are going on an economic zone. If you are constructing a cable stayed bridge, yes, its economy starts if you have a larger span, say around 175 meter and beyond. So what is the solution in between, economical solution in between 100 and 175? That is the extradose bridge, which takes the advantages of both the solution, that is girder and extradose bridge, conglomerate them together and make a system which takes the advantage of both the systems. So that is called extradose bridge. Now, how it is different than if you are looking at a extradose bridge, how you can make it out whether it's extradose or cable stayed bridge from the physical appearance? First of all, the pylon height is nearly half the pylon height what you are going to have in a cable stayed bridge for a same given span. It's nearly 1/9 to 1/10 of the central span, while in case of a cable stayed bridge, it's used to be around L/5 of the central span. In extradose bridges, the cable lengths are not very long. It's ranges from 50 to 70 meter at the most, and it's subjected to very lesser, the overtension due to the frequent live load. That is the most important part. If you have an extradose bridge, and if you run a frequent live load over the bridge, you are going to have an overtension of the around 50 MPa. But if you have a cable stayed bridge, then it's going to be around 100 MPa. And that makes a lot of difference in what should be the maximum range of the stay cable utilization you can go for, because that is being limited by the vibration of the cable stay of the stay system. And that is being controlled by what is the overtension due to the frequent load can happen at. The superstructure depth. Now you can have two choices. Either you can, if you have a girder bridge constructed by cantilever construction, of course, you have to have a very least depth in the center of the span and keep on increasing toward the support as the bending moment and the shear force is increasing. But if you have a extradose bridge, choice is with you. If you can make it a constant box girder depth, or you can make it a tapered section towards the local tapered section towards the support. If you have a, say, I will say a range of, say, 140, 150 meter depth or span, you can go for a constant depth also. But if you have a 150 to 200 meter span, it's better to make it tapered depth near the zone to make it more economical. As far as the girder depth is concerned, at the support, the extra dose bridge superstructure depth is half the what you have a conventional girder bridges. So, if even with a 4 meter depth, you can range, you can span around 140, 150 meter span. But in a cable stayed bridge, which is primarily, as you said, that it's primarily taken, the loads are being picked by from at a regular intervals by the vertical component of the stays. So the girder is not very stiff. It's spanning only from stay to stay. So it's you can have a uniform 1.5 to 2 meter or 2.5 meter depth of a cable stayed bridge. Advantages: it's similar to girder's bridge as far as the construction is concerned, but there is no vibration, there is no fatigue problem as in case of cable stayed bridge. Aesthetic: it looks similar to a cable stayed bridge, but I will say it's better than the cable stayed bridge because the tower height is very small and it's a sleeker or comparable depth as compared to a cable stayed bridge. Construction: lesser tower height and than a cable stayed bridge. Constructing a tower of say 30 or 40 or 50 meter span is 50 meter height is not an easy job, but here the tower heights are not more than say 10 to I will say to 18 or 19 meter depth height. In terms of economics, yes, if you have using extra door bridge for a span range of 80 to 200 meter, you can save around 30% in material quantities, and it result in a lesser load on the foundation, and therefore there is an indirect saving also. Now, what are the general consideration whenever we used to conceptualize any extra dose bridges? First is the stay configuration. That is the first point, whether you want a single plane or double plane. Most of the time, it is being governed by the highway geometric. Whether you have a 2 plus 2 lane width of the carriageway, both sided, you can make a plane, you can make a single plane right in the middle. But if it is a 4 lane and with a footpath on one side or both side, then there is no option. You cannot make a single plane in the middle. You have to make it the double plane. So single plane or double plane is governed by the roadway widths and configuration. Stay layout, fan shape or semi-fan shape or half shape. In semi-fan shape, we are propagating from a point which are at a distance of a very small distance, but in a half shaped, the stays are parallel to each other. So the which type of stay cable configuration one should go for is governed by the, you know, how many number of cables you have in a given plane. And if you are working out the economics, I will say the semi fan shape is more economical than a half shape. So if you can make it semi fan shape, you should go, that should be your first priority. Superstructure is mostly governed by the what is the stay configuration, that is single plane or double plane. And secondly, what is the width of the total box or total roadway width you, or box width you wanted to accommodate the roadway and the footpath configurations. If you have a central supported superstructure, like when I'm saying central supported, it means single plane right in the center. Then you can have a single cell box girder with internal struts with wide cantilever, and you can have a transverse post tensioning also in the deck slab. And if you want to make it more wider, then you can have a single cell spine box girder with external struts to support wide girder. And if you want more further wide, you can make a single cell spine box girder with internal strut as well as external struts to support the wide cantilevers. So you have a three different options when you are making a central supported superstructure for various widths of the box girder. When you have a laterally supported box girder, when I'm saying laterally supported, it means you have a two plane. You can have a single plane box girder But once you are using single cell box cutter, in that case the box width has to be as wide as the carriageway or the box, the required width. Or you have to make out a cantilever, a very stiff cantilever beam, out triggering from the center of the every box segment and support it from there. Or you can have a multiple cell box cutter also to have a laterally supported superstructure. The third option could be a laterally supported stiffened slab box section. You make a two longitudinal beams supported by the cable state, but you put a cross beams integrating both of them and making a road width over it. That is also possible. So the superstructure configuration is being governed by again the stay configuration and the roadway width requirement. The third option, the third criteria is the pier superstructure connection, whether it should be through bearing or whether should one should make a integral to the superstructure that is monolithic like a building frame. Again I will say it's being governed by the ease of construction, the strain induced effect you are going to impart in this superstructure. When I'm saying strain and use effect, it can be creep of the concrete due to the pre-stress, the shrinkage of the concrete, and the most important are the thermal effects, global temperature fall and rise. If you are constructing a bridge where the temperature variation is quite a lot, then yes, it's not ideal to go for it. But yes, the other factors which governs it, that you have a seismic zone. Like in Delhi, we have a very high seismic zone. So if a monolithic connection is a better connection than a bearing system, as far as the redundancy required to restrain the seismic effects. Then comes to the pylon and pier configuration. It again depends on the central or lateral stay suspension system, what you have it. If you have a single plane of stay, yes, you can make a single pier and single pylon and support it. But if you have a double plane, you have to of course make a double pylon. Either you bring it down vertically or you make it spread down or you make an overhang beam. So choices are many. So you have to first, while conceptualizing, take care of all these points, draw it first and then go further. I am giving some examples now, whatever we have discussed. So it's a single cell box girder with a strut system in the center and surround 28 meter box width and transversely pre-stress because it has a very large overhangs. So it's a single stay plane of stays and half shape. You can see all the stays are parallel to each other. So this is called half shape. So it's a centrally supported single cell box girder with wide cantilever and deck is transversely pre-stress. Another point is a single pylon with single pier, monolithic with the superstructure. This is another example where the single cell box girder is being used, but the struts are being provided in a very peculiar fashion, from aesthetic point of view of course, to support the wide cantilevers. And it's again supported on the bearings, and here the cables are semi-fan shaped. So you can imagine that if you have a single plane, you can have a, in this particular case, you have a cross diaphragm at every stay system location. This is another example where the semi-fan shaped double plane stay system is being used, because it says the box width is equivalent to the carriageway width. So you cannot make a plane of stays in the middle of the carriageway. So you have to use a two plane. So if we used to call it laterally supported single cell box cutter. And finally the width is not so long that that the pylon which is coming from top, we are molding it and making it a one pier at the base. But if you have a wider girder, like in this case, then yes, you can bring the one leg of the pylon and bring its leg, and then you join them together at regular interval to make it a one to behave it monolithic, contiguously. This is another example where the designer brings the pylon. The same pylon is bringing down, and it is supporting the web of the box girder also while coming down. So there is no cross beam here, or a cross beam is there which is very small, because the web is also supported by the same column. So this is another example of the double plane system. Now, coming to the hardwares, the most important part of this cable stay or extra doors based system or any cable stays base is the stays cable. If that fails, everything gets fails. So one has to be very careful while formulating the specifications, while formulating your requirements at the time of the your conception. This is a cable stay, this is a cable stay which is anchored here, going to the pylon. So we have a different options here. So this is called free length of the cable. This is the zone where the transition is happening from the free length to the anchorage location. So that is called transition zone. And this is called anchor zone. And this is again called anchor zone. And this is a saddle. So you have a different corrosion protection requirements at different zones of the cable. And one must have a knowledge, of a complete knowledge, while formulating its specification. Let's start with the stays. Yes, the stays is nothing but a, it says parallel stays, parallel strand system. And parallel strand system means we are like in a precessing steel. Yes, we have a 7-ply strand. And in a conventional precessing post tension girders, we used to make a 7-ply strands and bundle them together in a cable and stress it. But here, apart from this, first of all, the first corrosion protection or barrier is these strands are galvanized. It has a zinc coating. Then it is being extruded in a SDP duct. And the interstices between the each ply of the strands is being filled with wax or grease. So you have a first protection is your is a galvanized. Second is being filled with the grease. Third is the it is extrude co-extruded in the SDP duct, and then all these co-extruded strands are being bundled together, put in a bigger SDP duct. So there, this is the fourth level of protection. So you have a four level of corrosion barriers in the cable stays. If any of these barrier fails, your bridge is going to last long, but this will require a replacement, which is very difficult to do so before the design life of the superstructure. Now, if you have a lesser grease quantity, it will fail in the water tightness. If you have a more grease than what is actually required, then in that case, this strand is start moving, or there will be a microscopic movements can happen between the strand with respect to the outer SDP duct, which is also not desirable. So it's always a patented system of the supplier that what they should go for. But these are the limits. One should not be lesser than that, one should not be more than that. The P thickness of the individual sheet is around 1.5. And yes, there should be a minimum frictional sheet and strand strength which is around 160 Newton per meter length. Then the SDP duct which is being put outside the complete duct, it is in two part. One is a high density polyethylene with a colored external layer, and internal layer is black, and its thickness is 6 millimeter per. The strand alone has a various properties, physical properties, and it is available in various diameters. So while making a design, you must know which kind of product is going to be easily available: 15.3, 15.7, Even in 15.7, there are two strengths available. So ideally, one should go for the last one, because this will give you the most maximum strength in a smaller diameters. That is 15.7 and 1860 millimeter MPa strength also. That is 150 millimeter square. So all the strength alone are to be also tested for the fatigue for 2 million cycle with the upper stress of 0.45 UTS and with the amplitude of 300 MPa. And you have to make sure that after the test, and when you go for a ultimate tensile strength, it should not be more lesser than 95% of the maximum ultimate tensile strength. So you have to do all this testing. Then comes to the anchorage and the transition zones. Different supplier has a different system, and this is what you are seeing right now is a VSL system, where in this grip zone, the strand has been naked. So wedges are holding the naked part of it, but even in this zone, the strands are not naked, and the polyethylene sheet has been taken out. So it's not a four-level corrosion protection. So they used to provide some external corrosion protection system in this zone. So you must have a knowledge of complete that how it is being done. In a Dividac system, what you are seeing right now, the PE tube is bought right till the end. Even through this bearing plate, only in the wedges location, it is being naked off. And where it is being naked off, it is again filled with another corrosion protection barrier. But yes, there are advantages and disadvantages of this system also. Because when we stress the cable, there is elongation. So you have to pre-calculate those elongation and make sure that after taking account of those elongation, the PE tube should come up to that point. But in actual set, you never get the same elongation what you have theoretically calculated. So if the elongation is going to be more than what you have conceptualized and you are still stressing it, there may be that it will peel off your or damage your PE tube of the individual strands. So one has to be careful while drafting the specifications or accepting any systems. Now the saddle is a very important part of a extra-dose bridge. Normally in a cable state bridge, we used to have a anchor system at the superstructure and anchor system at the top also. At top it's a dead end and at bottom it's a live end. But in an extra-dose bridge, we never used to go for that system. We used to take the cable or the strands through the pylon and to the other end of the superstructure end. So to pass this cable, you can say hardware is required, which is called saddle, and there are various design objectives which it is supposed to fulfill. First it should be able to pass the extra dose cable over the pylon, and when it is passing over, yes, it should be able to transfer the radial forces to the pylon with minimum horizontal forces. Secondly, you can imagine that if you have a extra dose bridges and you put a live load in one span only, another span doesn't have a live load, it means the stay which is supporting the span which is getting live load, having a live load, is going to have more tension than the stay which is anchored on the other side, which is not having any live load. So there is an unequal live load in the same cable. But you are not allowed to, the saddle is not supposed to allow the movement of the strands or the cables on either side of it, even under unequal distribution of the live load on either side of the pylon. So it means the unequal force which is transferred through the strands or the stays on either side of it has to be transferred to the pylon, but without any movement of the stay. So the saddle should be able to fulfill my dead purpose also. Third, strand by strand should be replaceable even during a certain movement of the traffic. You know, there is a possibility that strand by strand, it cannot be removed. You have to replace the complete cable. But once you conceptualize that, it means you should have a very large residual compression in the superstructure. Only then you can do it. Otherwise, you should go for a strand by strand system where you require very minimum additional residual compression system, and live load is still plying while replacing the cables. One of the codal requirement is that if any of the stray system or the stray breaks due to any accident, it should be the structure should not collapse. It should be able to hold. So in that condition, the saddle should not get damaged, and it should be compact in size, of course. So these are what we have seen the design considerations. What is fretting corrosion? That if you have a two steel parts of nearly equal hardness, if you have a small relative movement between the two adjacent hard materials, the corrosion starts. That is called fretting corrosion. So while conceptualizing saddle, you must take care that fretting corrosion doesn't happen. So now the solutions are, you have a single tube or monotube system, you have a multiple tube or multi-hole system, or you have an anchor system. So we are going to discuss all the solutions in detail and see what are the pros and cons of each solution. Before going further, as per the codal requirement, whatever the saddle you choose for, the complete assembly of a saddle with a stay passing over through it, anchored at two ends, subjected to a 0.45 UTS, and then giving an amplitude of around 200 MPa, and then you have to give a lateral movement in the center of nearly plus minus 5 milliradians. This is supposed to perform while accepting any saddle system. So now let's start with the monotube saddle system. In this system, you have provided a steel tube. All the strands, a bundle of strand has been passed in this single tube, and is being filled with the cement grout in the zone where it's passing over the pylon. This is the most crude method being adopted in earlier part of the when extra dosage bridges have been constructed. You can imagine that because of this deviation, all the strands are at the bottom, and you can well imagine the grout which you are filling it is not going to go into the interstices of this bottom zones of the strand system. So it's literally there is no grout. Even there is a grout, it will crack with time, because there is always a macroscopic movement happening in these strands whenever there is an unequal stray forces because of the unequal live load distribution on either side of the pylon. So first you have made it, these strands you have made it naked, because you assume that this naked strand is going to make a bond with this steel, and then this steel is going to put a radial component here, and then you have this shear key which is going to transfer the load to the concrete part of the pylon. I think this assumption is not going to give you a corrosion protection. Now why this is not a circular hole? If it is a circular hole, you can imagine that if there is going to be unequal distribution, then how the force is getting transferred from the strand to the pylon. These are the contact points, and these contact points creates a friction between the hole and the strands, and then it is transferred to the ductile material to the steel box, and then the steel box is having a shear struts which transfers the forces to the pylon. Then FISNET has developed another system. What they have done, they said we are not going to peel off the PU tube. They are still retaining the PU tube, but the filler material they have replaced with another patent, their material polymer, there is another polymer which is their patent, and they used to can, and they used to say that these polymer will make sure that there is a cohesive bond between will be formed between the steel and the outer PE tube. And when there is going to be unequal distribution, this cohesive bond will be able to transfer the forces to the PE tube, and then PE tube will transfer to the grout which is being filled up in the outer side of the tube, and then it will transfer to the outer casing and then outer casing to the pylon. So they used to say it is a coho strand. So wherever, whenever they used to make extra dose bridges with their patent saddle system, they used to fill this interstices with some other patent material, which is they used to call it coho strand. Now DVDAG, yes, they have developed another system which is called monotube system, multiple monotube system, and each tube, through each tube the again the strand goes, but they again doesn't peel off the PE tube. They used to take the epoxy coated strands through it. So which is again, you know, in all these solutions what they are trying to avoid is the fretting corrosion. There should not be any steel to steel contact, and there should not be any concrete to concrete contact also. Now this is a more generic system which has come up now, that you bring your stay anchored on one side of the pylon as a dead anchor. You bring the another stay anchored at the other end of the pylon as a dead anchor, and you provide a steel beam which is a tension end, of course, to transfer the forces, radial forces as well as unequal forces in the stays to the pylon. Now a disadvantage of this system, I think this, here you are not peeling off any tube, you are not putting any radial forces on the strand, but what the disadvantage of this system, that if any of this cable breaks off due to any accidental breakage, you can well imagine that the stay on the other side is still intact. So there is a very large unequal force being imparted on the pylon, and as per the codal requirement, if any of the stay breaks, it doesn't mean that the force of this is gone away. You have to impart equal and opposite. You know, when any cable breaks, it put an impact, and that impact is always opposite to the what it is, the actual forces, and that impact is not one time, it's one and a half after two times. So first this force is gone away and this force is there, and another you are putting a one and a half times more. So it means nearly 2.5 times force you are imparting on a pylon. So yes, this is a very generic system. This is a very simple system. You have fabricated a steel beam with a submerged arc welding, and you have done everything in house and saved a lot of money. But what about the pylon? You have to design a pylon for a 2.5 times if stay force as an unequal force at a such a height from the superstructure. So yes, there are pros and cons of each system, and it's up to left to the designers always that what it choose for. And I must tell you that it's very difficult to choose. Now we are starting a real time example, and there is a bridge which is coming up in Delhi across Yamuna River. So there is a bridge called Barapula Bridge, although this bridge is under construction for last 4-5 years. We are constructing in parts. First we have made it operational for around 5 kilometer length, and from Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium to Saraikale Khan. Now we are extending that bridge to Mur Vihar, which is another very high habitat area. And in next phase, which is up to 2020, we'll extend it back to the airport. So you take off from airport and land up nearly 25 kilometer away from the airport in East Delhi of this. And this extra dose bridge is 552 meter long length. This is a GAD of the extra dose bridge. At the top you are seeing a longitudinal elevation. The foundation is of course well foundation, because this cover is in the range of, maximum cover is in the range of around 30-32 meter. So you cannot go for a pile foundation, otherwise it will be too slender. Then we have a span configuration of 85, then there are three central span of 127.5 and then again 85. There are another bridges which are in the same line, and there the span is in the range of 42.5 meter, multiple spans. So what we have done, we have removed one pier from here, removed two pier from here, removed two pier from here, removed two pier from here, removed one pier from here, so that the bridge piers are in one line. Now this 127.5 meter span, there are three numbers. So what we have done as far as the structures is concerned, there is expansion joint located at P1 and another expansion joint is located right in the middle of the central span. Have you ever heard having expansion joint right in the middle of a major span? But yes, you can do it. You can do it in extra-dose bridges or a cantilever constructed bridges. So there is a one joint at P1, another is in the middle of central span of the P3 and P4, another is at P6. So if you see mathematically, each unit, this unit and this unit is forming a pi structure. Why I am saying pi? These piers are monolithic with the superstructure. So these are the two leg of a mathematical symbol of pi, and then you have a superstructure running from this point to this point. So you have a two pi's and you have hinged them together at the center. So this is a very, you can narrate this in a basic form. Yes, in plan you can see there are two carriageways. It means there are two boxes and each box is catering for three lane of traffic plus a 5-foot path and cycle track which is around 4.6 meter wide on one side. So each box is around 20.8 meter and you have a two carriageways like this. So ideally we are making around 1100 meter length of the extra dose bridge, and so you have to model although this design and this design is the same, is a mirror image of the two. Now each you have a lower part of the pylon which is in the form of a double leaf pier or twin pier, you can say wall shaped pier. And then you have a upper pylon, which is again a double plane of stays for each box cutter. And there is a very stiff beam, which picks up the load from this load from the pylon and transfer it to the pier. And this stiff diaphragm is being positioned right at the pier location. And the pier, what you are seeing, is double wall shaped piers. So this is and it is supported on around 14 meter circular diameter of wells which is going around 48 meter into the below the bed level. This is a section of a 28.8 meter box. The traffic is going to ply in this, and there is a footpath and cycle track in this, and the overhang, what you are seeing, small overhang, is to accommodate the stays outside the crash barrier locations. Each pylon has six numbers of cable stays, and the angle of the stays is around varying from 16 to 30 degree. Then the pylon height is, although we have made a crown at the top from the aesthetic consideration, but the last is around the last the stay which is anchored here is around at a location of around 14 or 15 meter at the from the superstructure top. This is again you can see the double thin wall shaped piers. It's very flexible, is 1.25 meter thick only. From this point to this point, and then we have taper it as we go up to 1.5 meter here. If you are going to put an expansion joint in the middle of this central span, you can well imagine that if the leg load is going to come in one overhang, it is going to deflect with respect to the other overhang, which we want to avoid it. So what we have done, we have put a very stiff I-beam, box beam, steel box beam, You can see this box beam and this box beam. This box beam has been positioned inside the cell of the box cutter, and we have created a diaphragm action here, and this diaphragm action is being done at this point, and this point. So this is one unit, this is another unit, and there is a strip beam. Now if the live load is going to come here, this strip beam will make sure that there won't be any unequal distribution of the deflections with respect to each other. So that is the one purpose of this beam, and we used to call it shear beam or hinge beam. There won't be any relative deformation with respect to between the two units, and there won't, and the slope of this part of it will always remain same. So this is a very good arrangement. One can make it even in a conventional cantilever constructed bridges also. So your span configuration remains the same, but you're providing an expansion joint right in the center and making a continuity of the superstructure. So the structure is free to deform longitudinally, but it is not free to deform vertically with respect to each other. It is not free to deform transversely also with respect to each other. You can well imagine that if there is going to be a transverse wind, yes, this structure is allowed to deform in this fashion, but it should not happen. One should start deforming related to each other. So you have to provide a bearing system at these locations, top and bottom, in such a manner that if there is a live load, there is a sagging moment happening, then yes, the pink, the orange color start getting activated, will be under compression, and there is going to be a hogging moment, which can also happen in case of earthquake or a live load put at the outside the or on the adjacent span. Then the bearing which are blue in color are getting activated in vertical direction. But when you have a transverse, yes, you have to make sure that there should not be any transverse movement happening, relative transverse movement happening between the two units. I am going back to the first figure which you have seen it. So you can well imagine that there is an expansion joint here. So this unit and this unit can move or translate longitudinally freely. There is no restriction as far as this joint is concerned. But if it comes to the vertical deformation, there won't be any relative deformation between the two each other. Transversely, there won't be any relative deformation between the two each other. And the slope at this point will remain the same. So you have to create this boundary condition while making your analytical model. So this is a close view of those analytical models. This is a B model. We have created just a solid pictures of the same. Now these trays, how to model it? We have modeled it as a truss elements, which can take tension as well as compression. You can ask me why these trays can take it. Trays cannot take a compression. It can always take it. It always take the tension. But you have, while modeling, you have to take it as that it should be able to take tension as well as compression. Why? Because you are using the same model for your live load analysis. So this stray, you know, when we have constructed this bridge, we put a tension in the stray of the values which we wanted. But if the live load comes, there may be possibility that this tension will get you will get more tension, or there will be a relief of tension. So in those cases, this truss element should able to take compression as well as tension, because it doesn't mean that this element is going under compression. It's just that you are leaving the tension. There will be always a tension, but by giving a compression, you are leaving the tension. So I have seen some models where the people are taking this truss element as a tension only and doing a live load analysis, which is not correct. Now in extra dose bridge, you have a lot of loads which you have to cater for. Dead load effects, which is going to come from the dead load and stray effect, which is going to come from the a construction stage analysis. Then you have to put a SADL, which is a permanent surfacing, And then you have to take a feature overlay also. This SIDL feature overlay don't put as a construction load. You put only permanent and as a surfacing load, which is going to be there as a construction load, which takes account of the creep and creep effect of the also. But this SIDL feature overlay always put as a static separate load case, because this will be there or this will not be there. So you have to model in such a way that this can be, this will be there, and this without this, the structure should be safe. Then of course the creep and shrinkage effect has to be taken, the pre-stress effect has to be taken. This pre-stress can be internal boundary tendons or it can be external unbounded tendons also. So there is a pre-stress effect as again two effects, that is primary and secondary. Then there is a live load vertical, vehicular live load vertical effect, vehicular live load braking and tractive effects, then footpath live load, then thermal loads. Now thermal loads, in a conventional way we used to say, okay, we have taken care of the thermal gradient across the depth of the superstructure. Yes, we have to take care of that one also. But apart from that, being an integral structure, you have to take care of the global temperature fall or rise, because this is nothing but a strain induced effects. Then you have to also take account of that if there is a differential temperature between stress and the superstructure. Because what is the stress? Stress is a steel. It will get hotter much earlier than the superstructure. When there is a sunshine, the steel get much earlier hotter than the superstructure. So you have to also take care of differential temperature being, temperature is there between the stay and the superstructure. Then there is a pylon which is as wide as 4.5 meter or 5.5 meter depth along the longitudinal direction. And when there may be possibility, then this sun rays come and it is coming only on one face of the pylon and other face is in the dark. So there can be a thermal gradient can be formed along the length of the pylon along in the elevation. So you have to take account of all these thermal effects, and all these thermal effect has to be combined together to one effect which is called total thermal effect. Then differential settlement of pier supports, because it's a continuous unit and this foundation has a tendency to settle, and there can be unequal settlement happening between the adjacent piers. So you have to take care of that. You have to take care of earthquake effects, and earthquake effect can be vertical, transverse or longitudinal. Then there is a wind, which is a longitudinal drag forces on the superstructure. There can be a transverse force effect of the wind. There can be a vertical effect of the wind. So you have to take account of all these effects, and you have to make sure that you are doing everything in one file. That is the most important. You know, if you are not using a sophisticated software, then you may end up that you are working out these effects separately and spending your half of your design time only in combining those effects and making sure that it combines properly. So you can do everything in one file, all these effects, and get away with it. Now what I am trying to show before going further, I want to show you a quick movie of the Barapula Bridge, which shows the complete construction scheme. The construction is started from pylon number P2, which is the penultimate pier. The pier segment is being casted first. I'm going further. The pier segment is being casted first. Then we have constructed the pylon with the saddle in position, erected the lifter. This is a precast segmental construction, okay? So we have erected a lifter we can lift the segments from the ground, and we have put a cantilever cable. We have done the epoxy gluing, then temporary precessing, and then cantilever cable. Then the lifter is moved forward, another lifter is being positioned on the other side, then it's being lifted. Now, first segment has been erected. Now we are erecting the second segment equally on both sides, and cantilever cables are going from 2 to 2. Then we are lifting the third one simultaneously. You can lift one by one, but when you are fixing to the superstructure, it has to be done simultaneously. Then you are lifting the fourth, and after positioning, stressing the cantilever cable, you are putting the stay number S1, and it's being stressed. Then I am putting segment number S5, and again stressing S1 cable. Then putting 6, stressing cable number S2. Putting 7, again stressing S2. Then putting 8, again stressing cable, stay cable. Then 9, 10, and I am keep on propagating equally on both sides. But what's happening, each day I am stressing 2 times. One, when it is being, the segment is where it is supposed to be anchored, I am stressing to some value. Then I am erecting another segment, then again stressing to a higher value. Why, I will tell you. So I am keep on propagating it like this, I am stressing each cable 2 times. So S15 has been erected. S16 has been erected. And now I am stressing all the cables again, one by one. So P2 has been totally erected, similarly P3 has been totally erected. There is a gap in between. There is a gap in between. What I am doing now, I am putting a jack force, pushing each cantilever in opposite direction. And then casting the in situ pole, stressing the integration cable, and then doing the end span, doing the integration cable. And then again stressing the whole units, and similarly I have done the other and installed the hinge beam. So this is a complete construction scheme. So before going into a detailed analysis, first you draw all these construction stages, give them a numbering, give them the sub stages in a major stages, and make your file in such a manner that the number what you have given in the drawing, same should be there in your file also. Otherwise, you will lost. Now, coming back to one of the stage, I would like to go back. Right now, when I have stressed the S10 segment, I have done the stress the cantilever cable from here to here. Stress this tray to some value, and then when I have erected the next one, S11. I again stress the same stay again. Why you not stress the stay right in one go? Why I am doing in two stages? Why? Because if you are going to stress this stay in one go, you are going to get a tension in the bottom. So your this joints will get open up. Although you have a temporary precessing, but it has a limitation. So you stress a value which temporary precessing can taken care of. Normally in pica segmental 0.3 MPa is good enough. But in this type of bridges, where even after doing in two stages, I have to put a nearly 0.8 MPa of the temporary pre-stress using separate bar system, which is a huge expenditure. So even after doing in two stages, still I have to put more than what is minimum required. And if I do it in one go, you can well imagine what is going to happen. So I want to go to another stage. Yes. Now I have erected this cantilever and this cantilever also. What I am doing, I am putting a jack here, right in the middle, at neutral axis of the box girder, and imparting equal and opposite force. Why I am doing it? First, you can well imagine that this the cast in situ pole which I am going to do is going to have more creep deformation because I am stressing the integration cable at much younger day than rest of the precast segmental construction, which is having a large strength and it is much older. So that is the first point. Second point, when I am going to stress this integration cable, it's a portal frame. The structure is trying to shorten up because of the pre-stressing. The concrete is have a concrete is elastic material, so it has elastic shortening because of the precessing. So it is going to induce very huge forces, shear forces in the piers, and these shear forces I have to transfer it to the foundations. I don't want to design for those forces. What I am doing, let's say I put some force of 200 ton, 300 ton, and I know that the shear which is going to come after integration of these two cable is of 400 ton. So what I am doing, I am putting a 200 ton force, so that net only 200 ton shear is going to come in the pier instead of 400 ton. Thirdly, when I am going to take out this, after doing this stitching, I am going to take off this load, is going to give a pre-compression in my cast-in-situ portion also. So this, the joint which is the having maximum bending moment, having the least strength, stress at a most younger day, I am giving it more pre-compression artificially, and also helping my pier to negativate the force which is going to come because of strain induced effect, which is going to come because of the shortening of the concrete in this part of the superstructure because of precessing. So in one go I am taking care of all the things. So all these ULS and SLS combinations can be done in one go, in one file, because the Midas has a capability of making a bending moment envelope, combining two bending moment envelopes, comparing two bending envelopes, and giving another envelope. This envelope can be combined with another envelope. Not only the bending moment or shear forces, it can be done in stresses also. So this is what we are looking from a software to do it. Okay, what I am showing you, a stress in the top fiber and the bottom fiber at the end of the complete construction stage. You can see that over the pier, I'm having a stress range of nearly 15 MPa, and in the center of the span I'm having a range of around 6 to 7 MPa in the center of this. So the top fiber is blue color and red one is bottom fiber. Now coming to the pre-stress, again we have discussed what's happened. You have a primary effect and secondary effect. So this is a pre-stress primary effect, and why there are two diagrams, because as we have discussed that as per IRC 112, we have to have an inferior pre-stressing effect as well as superior pre-stressing effect. When you have inferior means you have to multiply the calculated pre-stress effect by 0.9, and superior means you have to multiply the pre-stress effect by 1.1 for a post-tension member. So you have a two diagrams, and you have to use these two diagrams for all your further calculation. So similarly, you have an axial effect, again an inferior effect and superior effect. And this is the stress diagram of inferior and superior of top fiber and bottom fiber. That's why you are getting four diagrams. And you can well imagine that it's all here the negative stress means compression. Then you have a pre-stress secondary effects. Again, you have a normally in a conventional continuous unit girder bridges, we used to have a secondary effect as a straight line from pier to pier. It's never curving like this. But because of this stress, you have a curvilinear secondary effects. So this is a pre-stress secondary effect bending moment diagram, inferior and superior, and similarly pre-stress secondary effect. Axial effect, what is this? And this axial effect is, you can see it's a negative. A negative means tension. Sorry, here it's a positive. Positive means tension here. Why this is there? Because this is a portal action, and when I pre-stress it, there is going to be a shear formed in the pier, and which is in opposite to the pre-stress, and that put a tension in the superstructure, and that tension is a nothing but a secondary effect of the pre-stress, and it is not there in the middle of the two piers. It's also there in the end span because it's being joined together by the stress. That's why you are getting it in the end span also. So why I'm showing you all this diagram? That don't give an input and write that everything what will be analyzed by the software will be correct. You have to see your diagram and make a logical sense whether it's going in a correct direction. The value which you are getting is reasonable or not. So you should, you know, you have to see in a graphical format all these things and judge whether your each and every load effect you are calculating it correctly or not. And then yes, you are supposed to make a load combinations and envelopes. And so now this is a pre-stress secondary effect, and again it's a stress diagram. Now when you are making a load combination of total pre-stress effect combining primary and secondary, don't make a inferior and superior envelope. You should not do that primary pre-stress envelope is this, secondary pre-stress envelope is this, and let's combine them and use for further calculation. Don't do it like this. You do pre-stress primary inferior combined with the pre-stress secondary inferior as a one value of total pre-stress effect. Similarly, you work out another pre-stress effect which is a pre-stress primary superior combined with pre-stress secondary superior and make it another, and work out the envelope of these two and use that envelope for rest of the combinations. Differential settlement of the pair, yes, you have to make sure that this pair can settle, or this pair can settle, or this pair can settle, or this pair, or this pair, all the six pair can settle one by one, or any of the combination can settle. So you have to the MIDAS software has a very good capability that you give the input in a very lucid manner, and you get the complete envelope of bending moment diagram which is mirror image of each other about the center line. And that's the check, one of the check. And yes, you can always check it whether you are the bending moment which you are getting is in the correct values also or not. So first you see the bending moment and then convert into stress envelope for the top fiber and the bottom fiber. Now IRC 6 vehicular load combination, I think it's is the worst load combination you can imagine. And I've seen a lot of international live load combination, but IRC is unique. But yes, we have to follow it, we have to respect it. There is a class A combination, class A vehicular load. It can move forward, it can move backward. I'm just showing two trains only right now. You know, 20 meter is what is given here is a minimum. But it's a minimum, not a maximum. You can have any n value more than 20 to get the worst combination of shear force or bending moment or deflection. So your program should have a capability that it should be able to draw the first influence diagram and then can place these vehicles at the peak ordinates, keeping this point into mind. Then you have a similarly 70 a wheel, forward, backward. Right now I'm saying two train, it can be three train, it can be four train, depending on the length of the bridge. And what I'm talking about the 552 meter length bridge, I have taken six train. Then you have a 70 yard track, again 30 meter is the minimum distance. Then you have a lanes, you can have it's a three lane bridge with a footpath. So you have to first draw it graphically, that where you can vehicles can have it, the three lanes. So you first define all these lanes for different vehicle, for left side of the carriageway or right side of the carriageway. And then you define the vehicle configuration. Once you have defined them, then you define how many lanes can come in one go. So you have to take care of all these combinations while defining the vehicular live load, and it can be done in one file, vehicles. So these are the lane factor and impact factor, you have to take care of it. So what I am showing you right now, maximum sagging moment at the center of the, this is my P1 and this is P2 and this is P3. If I have to get a maximum bending moment at the center of the span, there are three vehicles have been positioned here and three vehicles have been positioned here. based on the ILD ordinates. You can well imagine that the ILD ordinate will be like this, going up, down, then going down, and then going up, and then coming down. So if you place the live load here and here, you are going to get the maximum bending moment at the center of the span. This is a zoom of the same. And you can see all the lanes of all the class A vehicles and their loads, their values, what the program is taking it. For the maximum bending moment near the support, the ILD ordinate is like this. And then this is reverse here, there is a reverse here, but if I place a live load here also, then yes, maybe I will get a more negative effect here. But I thought I have seen those values, it's coming out to be very, very small, so I ignore it. But important point is, you have to take account of how many live load vehicles can come from here to here. Because more number of vehicles you are going to increase it, more time the program takes care of. To run this file with a live load in position of 6 trains of all these vehicles, and I'm taking the forces of only a half the superstructure, it takes around 7-8 hours. So don't run each and every time your file with live load. You run your file by suppressing the live load effects. You do all your analysis. You work out this effect separately and take care of this type of cushion you have to take care in your final stress value. But when you run it, finally, yes, you run it one go and make that input and output separate for your life purpose also. Otherwise, you will not get a time of 7 to 8 hours to run this file. So I have got the final ILD, final bending moment envelope, live load bending moment envelope. This is the maximum negative bending moment on the superstructure, and this is the maximum sagging bending moment you can have in the superstructure. And then I am going to convert into the stresses. Sorry, I am not converting, the program is converting. And you have to use all these stress envelopes to combine with another stress envelope of other load effect. Again, footpath live load. You are not supposed to place the live load, footpath live load from one end of the bridge to the other end of the bridge. You will not get the maximum effect. You have to first, maybe you will place a small footpath pattern of the patch of the footpath live load in the end span, small patch of the footpath live load in this central span, then you place it here, you place it here, in first in patches, then you combine them together two span by two span. You do all this combination one by one, get its effects, take its envelope of all these effects and make a one envelope of footpath live load. And when this envelope you have get it, you combine this envelope with the rest of the other load effects. You understand what I am saying? Let's say I am having 6 span. So what I have done, first I have made 6. This is the stress envelope, again top fiber and bottom fiber, the compression and tension for the footpath live load. Then comes the global temperature fall and rise. And ideally, it's a portal frame, so ideally the effect should have been only in the central zone, but it's going in the end zone also because of the stress. Then you have a differential temperature gradient across the depth of the superstructure. You have to subdivide your superstructure by defining what is the width of the superstructure in every sub layer. So program will do automatically all this stress calculation for you. You have to define only a thermal gradient and the width of the superstructure in each thermal gradient slices at top as well as bottom of the superstructure, and program will give you the maximum stress as well as the minimum stress in top and bottom fiber. As per the PTI for cable straight bridges, it says that you have to consider a differential temperature difference between the stay and the superstructure, because the stay, which is a steel, gets heated up more fastly than the superstructure, and then there can be a differential temperature between the two. All these effects what I am discussing, the thermal gradient across the depth of the superstructure, the global temperature fall and rise, the state superstructure differential temperature fall and rise, then pylon differential temperature. You know, this is a pylon, and if the sun rays come from this side, you will realize that this part of the pylon is heated up more fastly than this part, and a linear gradient can form in the elevation. So you have to take, and when this linear gradient is formed, the pylon will get swayed in one of the direction. So there are four thermal effects, and I've got envelope of all the four thermal effects. Now what I'm going to do, I'm combining all these four them together as a one thermal effect, which is this. So this diagram is giving me the stress envelope at top fiber and bottom fiber, tension and compression, or I will say minimum or maximum of all the four thermal stresses combined, thermal effects combined together. So once I have got the thermal load effects, so what I have made all the load combination as well as load combinations, and with a live load leading effect and rest with thermal load as a accompanying effect. So I've got the stress envelopes, and all are under compression. You have to make sure. Then I have made a live load leading with wind load accompanying. Then live load, thermal load leading with live load combination as a accompanying, because there are different load factors. Then wind load leading with live load accompanying. And then all these four SLS cases, envelope of this, all these four SLS load combinations, I have made another envelope to see it as only one envelope. Okay, if this envelope is my passing, it means all my rest of the things are going to be safe. So you have to work in an envelope form. And good thing in MIDAS is that you can make this load combination and envelopes without running your file. Like in STAT, if you are making any change in the inputs for making the load combinations, and although it doesn't give envelope except the live load, you make any load combination, you have to rerun it again. Here you need not have to rerun the file again. The program has calculated your all load effects. You can go at top and make all the load combination and see this simultaneously. Seismic analysis. We have performed a response spectrum analysis, which is a multimodal response spectrum analysis. It's a linear analysis, and as per response spectrum as given IRC 6 2014 with R equal to 1. And then later on, once you get the response reduction as R equal to 1, later on, depending on which element you are designing it, while making load combination, you can multiply or divide your load factor, response reduction factor along with the load factor into it separately. So here you have to define the response spectrum method, and you have to also define what are the scale factor. As you know, that in longitudinal transverse direction we have to take it 1, but in vertical direction it has to take 2/3 of the vertical horizontal one. So you can give a scale factor to the z value. So program will automatically take care of that in z, working out the z effect, it will take 2/3 of the horizontal effects of the response spectrum value. You can make it SRSS combination, CQC combination, or absolute summation or linear summations, depending on what summation you want it. If you have a time period which are very close to each other, you can choose the SRSS, but if the time periods are differing too much, then you can go for the CQC method. The choice is up to you. You will get an output which is showing the period of oscillation of each mode, their mass participation factor. From the mass participation factor, you can know whether it's a predominant longitudinal effect, or it's a predominant transverse effect, or it's a predominant vertical effect. And you can combine this, the program will convert this mode, and for each mode it will work out the acceleration from the response spectrum and the force, and then it make it combination. And finally, you can get a bending moment diagram, envelope, again an envelope for a longitudinal effect in the superstructure. It can be plus, it can be minus, it has to be symmetrical, of course. And this is the predominant mode which has come in the second mode, which is with 1.1 second. You can get a vertical mode which has come in mode 5, which is 0.92 second, and you can get a bending moment envelope because of vertical load, vertical seismic. And you can also get a predominant transverse mode, because in our case it's coming in 14 mode. In our case, our pier, you can see it's a ball shaped pier. So transversely the piers are very stiff. So that's why the time period is very small. And you get a bending moment envelope for the transverse mode. And then once you've got all this bending moment envelope plus minus, you can make a response combinations and use this as response combination with the rest of the loads effect to make the ultimate load case, ultimate load combinations. Then coming to, we have discussed that there can be a what is called accidental cable stray breakage effect. So as per the codal requirement of CITRA, you have to design your structure, superstructure, as well as pylon, which is anchoring both the end of the stays. Whatever the static force you have in the stay, 1.5 times you have to impart it equal and opposite to the respective elements. Okay, let's see it. This is my, I'm showing only the half elevation of the bridge. One of my stay has broken, this stay. Okay, but the complementary stay on the other side is still there. So this is the enlarged view of the same. So the code says whatever is the force you have in this cable as a breakage, before breakage, you have to, not only if this force is gone, there is going to be a dynamic impact of the same, which will be imparted on the structure where it is getting anchored. So this effect is very predominant if you are using a anchor system in the pylon, that the stay is anchored here. But if you are using a conventional saddle where the strand is going from here and then coming down, then the pylon is not subjected to, pylon is at the most subjected to a frictional force which is due to the frictional force into the generated due to the radial component of the stay force. That is the maximum force you can have it. So it means you are designing this pylon for 2.5 times force, and there you are designing only for 30 to 40% of the friction force which at the most one can have it. If it is a single plane, you have to give your input in such a manner that the complementary stays are always stressed together simultaneously as a synchronized manner. Second thing is, what is the minimum stress level in stay? You have to stress it in first time. When you are stressing for the first time, what is the minimum stress you have to keep it? Whether it's 0.15 UTS, 0.2 UTS, or 0.25 UTS, that your stay supplier will tell you. Because there is some minimum force is required so that the wedges can hold the stay in position. If the tension force in the stay is lesser than that, there is a tendency that the stay may slip through the wedges. Okay, that's the second. So you have to coordinate with the whosoever is your stay supplier, that is the minimum stress level at the first jacking. And yes, of course, you have to keep it bare minimum to avoid the requirement of the temporary precessing which you have discussed earlier. Third point is, when you are doing the second or third or fourth stressing, you know, when you are stressing it second times, you have to make sure that you are not holding the same point again by monostrand jack. Otherwise, it will bite the strand at the same location and it will break the strand. So there is a minimum elongation you have to keep it whenever you are stressing the strand. So that you have to also take care of. Okay, coming to the serviceable checks for stress, our different codes define the different values. But I will say that CITRA is the best code because it defines the correct specification specifically for extra dose bridges. So its value is ranging from, this is the formulation being given. So it's dependent on delta F frequent. Delta F frequent is nothing but the fluctuation of the stresses happening in these strays because of the frequent live load effect, not the complete live load effect. There is a fatigue live load effect. In our IRC6 now, there is a fatigue live load effect has been defined. So you have to use this delta F as a fatigue live load effect, not the total live load effect. So if you impart what is the 30 MPa or 40 MPa, whatever is happening, So up to 50 MPa, if the stress range is only up to 50 MPa, the stress range in SLS condition remain 0.6 UTS. You can go up to 0.6 UTS in SLS combination. But don't stress the pre-stress cable to 0.6 UTS because there is an upper limit in ULS also. So, in ULS, the code says, this is the formulation being given, that if you testing, you do a testing of the stress as a category B mechanical test, then you can apply this load factor and you will end up with a 0.75 UTS. If you are not going to do a category B load mechanical test, then you have to load down your ultimate stress value also. You have to take a 55 strand assembly and not more than 2% of the cable should break in this test. And after this test, you take a strand, all the strands one by one, and do a ultimate testing, and it should not fail at 95% of its minimum tensile strength. If it passes, then this is called category B mechanical test. In our case, you know, in ultimate, our values are reaching to around 0.72, 0.71. And that too, only when I kept my SLS state to around 0.47, 0.48 UTS. I am not going to 0.6. If this blue line has reached to 0.6 UTS, which I can do it, then in ultimate it will go up also. And what is ultimate? Ultimate checks are for the stays are earthquake conditions, because in as per IRC6 now, you have to check your superstructure, the stays in ultimate condition only with R equal to 1. Accidental load combination is ultimate condition. So the cable which was there around 0.47 UTS in a service condition, moment one of the cable breaks and the rest of the cable, if forces increases, that forces increases to around 0.75 UTS or 0.7 UTS. That is the effect. So you have to be very careful while defining the number of the strands, their configuration, and you have to check SLS and ULS. The program will not do it for you. Program will give you the stress value. The limitation, you have to define it. Then during construction, you have to always take care of various unbalanced load forces, which can be due to the differential gravity loads on one side of the cantilever and another side of the cantilever. This is all as per the codal requirement. You have to consider 35% increase here and 25% increase here, or 5% increase here and 5% decrease here. You have to do both the cases. That this cantilever is being made with lesser density of concrete and this cantilever is made with larger density of concrete. So this will induce the bending moments in your pier shafts. Then there can be a construction live load on one side of the cantilever. There can be a more concentrated live loads on the one side of the cantilever than the other side of the cantilever. Then lifting gantry and counterweight and rail weights, they can be at different positions also. Then there may be possibility that you have lifted the segment number 16 here, but this segment is still not lifted up. There may be condition that you have lifted this segment number 16, but while lifting this segment, you have an accidental fall. And because of this accidental fall, there is an equal and opposite effect of this lifter on this cantilever arm. And that will induce very high bending moment in this pier arm. So all this you have to consider while doing the construction live load cases. Coming to the transverse effect of the superstructure, you have to create 2D model, also 3D model, depending on what load effect you are working it out. As far as the dead load, SADL and FPLL, you can make a live load effects, of course with pre-stress also, because we have done a transverse pre-stressing in this model. So what you are seeing in the bottom is a dead load effects. This is a tendon primary and secondary effects. But while doing a live load effects, we have created a 3D model because we doesn't want to apply the effective width method as given in IRC6. We have simulated the actual properties of the slabs, webs, and the most important, the joints. It's a precast segmental construction joint. The joints can the joint of the between the two slabs can transfer the axial force. It can transfer the autoplane shear forces, but it cannot transfer the longitudinal bending moments. You cannot expect the 200 millimeter slab to transfer the longitudinal bending moments. Normally, in all our grillage models or finite element model we used to develop, if you are not modeling the joints correctly, then you will get a equivalent width for the live load factor much larger than what actually is. Then we have modeled a complete span also as a FEM. Why it is required? You can well imagine that when I'm holding a stay from these end points, this is a deck slab and these are the webs. This is just split it in two parts just to see the contour diagrams. So although it's a one model, I imparted a stay forces here, upward force and upward force here, activated the gravity load, and seeing there is a local tensioning is being found where the stays are getting anchored. This is red color. So I have to pre-compress this zone by a transverse precessing which is going like this. So what order we have to do, what order you have to put a transverse precessing? So at the center where it is getting anchored, I have to put two very high large strands here. And since the value is keeping reducing as you go away from it, I have reduced the transverse precess effect. So you have to work out these, you can work out only by FEM modeling of a complete span. You have to model a complete span, apply all the stay forces at its stop and apply the gravity load. You will get the contours, tension contours in the webs and a compression in the superstructure slab. So you take all this into account while designing your transverse reinforcement and the pre-stress, along with the other live load effect, other load effects. While lifting a particular segment, which you are lifting it only from four points, you have to model a segment FEM. And what you can do in MIDAS, you can take out any cut line and see its bending moment profile also of the FEM model of the deck slab. And based on this bending moment diagram, you provide the reinforcement and the transverse precessing. This is a FEM model for the saddle, what we have discussed, denailing system, to work out what are the tensile stresses are coming in different fibers and whether it's still within the limit of SLS, ULS and fatigue. You can see this is a skeleton diagram of a transverse precessing of transverse section of a box girder where the deck cables, the longitudinal cables, the stray cables, the web cables are crossing each other at this point. So you have to make sure that there is no clashing of the different precessings. And this is the final shape of the concrete, what you are going to see from the outside. That's it.